started there, and I'm still working on, is a whole concept of how we can move forward to change the way we deal with water, so that the most important principle would be watershed conservation, watershed preservation and restoration, rainwater capture, stormwater capture, conservation, all the ways we know to do this. We actually know all the things we have to do. We're simply not doing them, and we have no political will. But that has to be absolutely firm as a principle. I would say the second principle has to be equitable access to water, water as a public trust, water as a human right, water as part of our commons, not as something that is owned by somebody else. And we have a very deep struggle going on in the world between those who say water should be part of a market, regulatory system, let the market decide, put it on the open market for sale like running shoes or Coca-Cola, and we'll see. And they run the big water utilities on a for-profit basis, often in the global south, denying literally millions and millions of people who cannot pay their outrageous fees because they have to pay their investors, right? Or the bottled water industry. Last year we drank enough single bottles, plastic bottles, water in our world that if you put them end to end, they would reach the moon and back 65 times. That's the amount of garbage we created from this fetish that we have on bottled water. Or the market, the newest is that you will actually physically own water. And countries like Chile Chile's gone the farthest. Chile actually has public auctions where they actually sell off their water rights. And big companies, particularly, I have to tell you, Canadian mining companies are in there like a dirty shirt, bidding on water against local indigenous people and local farmers. Well, guess who's winning the bidding war? And physically, literally, the water is taken from those communities and given to the mining companies. Texas, there's a guy named T. Boone Pickens. You know him perhaps. He's a big energy guru, a very rich man. He's buying up water rights from the Ogallala Aquifer and just holding on to it until it's worth even more money. My first book on water was called Blue Gold. Until this water is even more gold, this blue is even golder than it is now. He's in his late 80s. I'm not too sure what he's waiting for, you know, but anyway, hoarding water. You'll be maybe not surprised to know that the first place to go private water markets in Canada is Alberta. So it's very interesting that we're beginning to see that here. But so this very deep struggle is taking place in the world around whether we're going to have the notion that water should be privately owned and whoever can buy it will buy it, and hopefully governments will take care of the poor, whoever those people are, right? Versus those of us who believe very deeply that water should be not only protected in ecosystems, but equitably accessible. Now that doesn't mean the human right to water for your swimming pool. Let's just be real clear here. We're not talking about a free-for-all. We're talking about the basic right of water for life. And then we look at the whole notion of whether we should be thinking about water as a source of conflict, or whether it would be possible that water could become nature's gift to us, to teach us how to live differently with one another. I think of the comet movies, you know, where from Hollywood there's a comet coming to Earth, and all of a sudden everybody's differences don't matter because everybody's going to die in 72 hours, so they send Tom Cruise up or whatever. I would say, take the wife, take the kids. No, I hate the wife's kids. And you know, he blows it up and he's a great hero, but we do have a comet. It is the global water crisis. In my opinion, it is the face of climate change. It is the first and most awful and most visible sign of desperate inequality in our world, but it is the first phase of climate change. And when you hear of climate refugees, they're water refugees. And it is, I promise you, going to get startlingly worse really, really quickly. Brand new World Bank study just came out. In the next 20 years, 20 years is a blink of an eye, the demand in our world is going to exceed supply by 40%. That sounds like such a dry number, but if you can imagine the human suffering that we're talking about, and the biological devastation, the biodiverse devastation that we're dealing with, we have to start taking this seriously. Just a couple of minutes about Canada, and then I'd like to talk to you rather than talk at you. Canada, we have what I call the myth of abundance. We believe we have all the water in the world. These may be problems for other parts of the world, but it's not problems for here. That is just a lie. We have a 40-year-old National Water Act. It's pathetic. They don't obey it anyway. The only thing that we have that's half decent is something called the Fisheries Act. And the Fisheries Act says you can't put anything deleterious into aquatic systems, deleterious to their fish, right? At least any given time, at least half the mining operations in Canada are in violation of the Fisheries Act, and that's a study right from the government itself. And now they've just brought in legislation, an amendment called Schedule 2, which allows a mining company to ask the government to apply to take a brand new beautiful lake and say it's no longer a lake, therefore it's not subject to the Fisheries Act. It is now redesignated as a tailing impoundment area, and we get to dump our toxins in it. And there are anywhere from 12 we know about, but we think there are probably 20 lakes scheduled to become no longer lakes, but tailing impoundment areas in Canada. One has already been designated, Sandy Pond in Newfoundland. We're fighting another one in BC. Any day it's going to get its designation. There's one up near Marathon in Ontario. So this is now happening across the country. Usually, by the way, in Indigenous communities, because here in Canada, like everywhere else, the Indigenous local people are seen as expendable, right? They're the ones that don't matter. So we're fighting, and we're going to be launching a court case very soon on that. Again, go to our website, Canadians.org, if you want to learn more about this. We need our environmental educators talking about Schedule 2. It's a terrible, terrible piece of legislation, and we're going to say that the regulation, the amendment to the regulation, violates the regulation. So that's going to be our argument.